overlook me here. Okay, so we just want to maybe connect with the children ministers at the church just briefly, and we can begin to set a time that we can all come together and get more involved and get the responsibilities distributed a little bit more evenly. And I think that everybody that has children, I think that this will be a perfect opportunity for you to join in and to be assistant, to assist with your children. I'm pretty sure that would be something that you would want to do anyway. All right, so also I want to make sure that I connect with everybody that not in Bible study during the week, you're not in prayer or whatever. We just want to make sure that we connect you some kind of way. I was out of town this past Wednesday, but normally I'm here, and we want to try to get everybody included, even if we have to do it not only on phone. If you just want it to, we can do it by phone. And we just want to make sure that everybody is, because I think that this coming month, August, we want to really begin to focus very heavily on souls. And we want to kind of renew our commitment, our passion for women souls. And I think that this is something that all of us are going to be able to do. And we're going to challenge you today, because I believe if everybody won one, for instance, like Sister Shirley Brown, is she here today? Okay, she reached out to her granddaughter.
Yeah.
And granddaughter, she has five children. And so we're going to have a half a bench almost, just from that outreach. And then Jackson, they reached out to the Butlers. The Butlers reached out to another family. And I believe everybody can win one. And we're going to begin to stress that. And we're going to ask everybody during the month of October to win, to reach out to one person. I mean, in other words, to invite them to come. And we want to begin to talk more about some other things that we want to do. But I think it's time for us to really develop that passion. In fact, our commitment could be completely reversed, and we could be enriched. We have quite a few people to work with, just through people that are attending, visitors. We can follow through. So we just want to begin to focus very heavily on outreach and the most important mission, the most important call, and the most important responsibility that we have as souls. Scripture says he that winneth souls is what? Wise. Amen. Just was quickened to me the other day. I was at the barber shop, and the last time I was there, I wasn't feeling very well. I mean, I was just small, real, had lost about 20 or 30 pounds, so I thought the barber had noticed that I wasn't normal, but he had noticed anything. But I had the opportunity to just, the Spirit just say, I had talked with him about his soul before, but just before he finished cutting my hair, I just brought the issue up. And I just say how easy it is for us to share Christ with people around us. You don't have to go through a whole lot of changes. You don't have to go out of your way. You can just ask people around you if your life ended, or you went into eternity today, are you absolutely sure that heaven will be your destiny? How long does it take to do that? But that is a very challenging statement, and I think that if you said that, I guarantee you that people would think about it, will make an impact on their hearts. I don't think anybody wants to be lost. Amen. So I think that it's incumbent upon believers to really bring the issue up and to begin to challenge people about their souls, because the scripture said that these people cross our path and we don't say anything to them, then the Bible says that their blood is going to be charged to our hands. Amen. So I feel challenged today to challenge you. Amen. I believe that if all of us would heed the message and accept the challenge and follow the teachings that we're going to be doing from now until probably a month or so, I believe that something will rise up within you that will cause you to want to share the gospel. It's not always you sharing it, but it's also you pointing them to a direction where they can be challenged or they can receive the word. You can do a whole lot. Testimonies do a whole lot. Amen, is that right?
Amen.
They do a whole lot. So if everybody win one, we just look around, you can see that these empty benches would be full. Amen. So, you know, I feel so strongly about this, I'm almost challenged to buy somebody $100 worth of gas if they, amen, make the strongest commitment to go and share. How many would like to leave $100 worth of gas?
Amen.
Nobody?
Yes.
All right. I feel so strong about that because I feel that the harvest truly is plenteous, but the labors are few. And I believe that Jesus is soon to come. And what we must do quickly. All right, let's have a word of prayer. Father, we thank you. We give you praise. We give you the glory in Jesus' name. The name above every name. We thank you for the victory. For this is the victory that overcometh even our faith. Lord, we stand on the word of God. Every promise in you is yea and amen. We give you praise and glory. We ask you to lead and guide and quicken all that we say, all that we do. Let it be done for the glory and for the honor of the Lord Jesus. We pray in Jesus' name. Everybody say amen.
Amen.
All right, I want to challenge you. This is our James 1. And, you know, I've been really challenged as I began to make a new commitment to read. And I almost read the book of Acts completely. And that stirs you up. Everybody just said the book of Acts. And the gospel, very essential. And we just want to continue to admonish you to read the word on a consistent basis, because this is actually how we learn to follow the example of Jesus. If you really want to know who you are in Christ, then you want to really covet the words that Jesus is speaking in the book, in the gospel. Amen. It shows you how he acts in righteousness, how masterful he was, and how he exerted dominion over the works of God's hands, and how he took authority over forces and demons and spirits and sickness. And this is the life you want to emulate. And this is how you really begin to get more righteous conscience and more masterful, just by reading the word. The scripture says the interest of the word giveth what? Life. It giveth understanding. So if you really want to begin to, if you really want to be wise, amen. How many want to be wise unto salvation?
Amen.
I don't mean street wise. I mean wise unto salvation.
Yes.
So if you really want to be wise unto salvation, you just begin to follow the blueprints of the scripture and the word of God. Make a commitment to get back to the word of God. Find time. Amen. You have to work this in your schedule. You have to prioritize, and you have to understand the importance of really putting the word of God at the forefront of your life. I believe David said that I love thy law, and I have esteemed thy precepts above gold. Amen. David really expressed his feelings towards his adoration. He expressed it very strongly. He said, "Oh, how I love thy law. It was my meditation all the day." How many can say that? "Oh, how I love thy law. It is my meditation all the day." Amen. Somebody said the word of God is designed to make you shouting glad or fighting mad. Fighting mad or shouting glad. Amen. That is really true. The Bible says the testimony of the Lord rejoices the heart. If you really want to get in a realm where you can experience continual rejoicing, Jeremiah said, "I found the word and I did what? Eat of it. Partook of it. And I found it to be the joy and the rejoicing of my heart." Amen. How many want to have a little bit more joy? A little bit more enthusiasm, motivation, zeal, favor, more to offer, more happy, more money? Amen. How many want to be in a position like that? And I think that the interest of the word, that's the thing that really gets the ball rolling. Because it places you or positions you in a place where, amen, the blessings of God will make rich, and scripture said, "Have no sorrow." David said, "Thou, through thy commandment," this is Psalms 112, I'm just kind of, it just can't hit me, Psalms 112, 97, "Oh, I love thy law, it is my meditation all the day. Thou, through thy commandments, has made me wiser than mine enemies, for they are ever with me." Amen. So you want to be wiser than your enemies. Amen. Natural enemies, whatever enemies you have. The scripture says, "The word will make you wiser than my enemies." The Bible mentioned that David had the wisdom of an angel to judge between right and anger, right and wrong. So the angel's wisdom comes directly from God. In fact, it's God speaking through an angel. Angels don't think for themselves. They don't come up with words and stuff to say. Everything that they said comes from what? God. David said, amen, that God had given, the scripture says that God gave David the wisdom of an angel. But David tells you exactly how his wisdom came. It came through loving the law. Amen. Now, I just want to encourage you and motivate you, because I know I'm looking at some that really don't have that drawing to the word. The word is not that attractive. It's not something that you crave or you hunger for. You get up in the morning with a real strong desire to feed on it. So I know I'm looking at some. The only way that you can learn to lack food that you don't normally like, name some of the foods you don't like. Broccoli. Fruits and vegetables. Period. All right. Love meat. You don't have to. All right. But what I'm saying is that the only way that you get to learn to love broccoli, I love broccoli. But I didn't like it when I first started. I just started eating it. And I began to develop an appetite for it. You will begin to develop an appetite for things as you begin to what? Eat them and partake of them. So the word of God is something that you really want to develop a strong appetite, because the Bible says it will make you wise until salvation. I mean, the wisdom of God, the Bible says the gospel is the power of God, and the Bible is the wisdom of God. And the wisdom of God is stronger than man. That's the reason David says God has made me wiser than all of my what enemies. Because the wisdom of God is what? Stronger than man. The foolishness of God, amen, is what? Amen. God has chosen the foolishness of his world to what? Confound the wise. Amen. So if you really want to be wise, if you really want to be a person that can really deal with souls and convince people that Jesus is the way and captivate their attention, amen, just feed on the word of God. And I'm going to share with you the aspects of the word of God that you really need to focus on. And I believe that through testimony, by inviting people, by being persistent, by showing concern for their souls, whether you know a lot or not, you can be very, very effective. I just want to encourage all of you that perhaps are not as experienced as I am, or others in the church, more than likely you could be a lot more effective than I could if you know a lot less in terms of winning souls. In the Bible, we see it over and over and over. The ones that were less experienced, the ones that were more effective. The woman at the well of Samaria, she had never even, amen, been in a church. She had never been to a teacher, never been taught nothing. She didn't know anything about the Word of God. And she went and told everybody that she knew, come see a man. Amen. The Bible says that the people, what? They came to see the man. And when they came, they believed. Amen. So you see this continuously over and over in the Bible. Usually they say, I'm going to see what y'all think about it, those that just get saved usually are most effective in getting people. Usually, I've seen this over and over in revivals. Well, I'm not really, haven't given y'all a subject or anything. All right, but I've seen this over and over in revivals that once you get people saved, maybe one person in the family saved, usually they go back and tell what? The other family members. What happened to them, how God has changed their life, how God broke the dominion and the power of sin from over their life. And they said, I want you to come and I want you to hear what I have heard. And more than likely, they will end up bringing their spouse or their children or their brother or their sister. And sometimes you have one or two persons. I mean, one person can sometimes bring, what, 6 or 12 people. They are motivated because the gospel, amen, has been received, they've heard it, they've seen the changes, they've seen the effects of the gospel, and they have a strong desire to see somebody else come and receive the same benefits and the blessings. David said, I have more understanding than all my teachers. See there, you can have more wisdom than your teachers. To me, the Bible says that, y'all think, why? Wisdom is the one that what, been in the church the longest and know most. And most times they're the one that what? Do less in terms of winning souls. Oh, amen. He said, I have no understanding of all my teachers. That's how you can get in front of your, I mean, ahead of your teachers. Amen. Who's this lady that, Sister Cynthia, down in prison? She's been there for over a year, and she is telling everybody. I mean, she's just as happy as she can be because she's probably told hundreds and hundreds of people about Jesus. Mm. I just can't wait until she gets out in July, I mean, in November, I understand.
Praise God.
Even before she went, she had all of her family members here pretty well.
That's right.
I mean, people like that, they are wiser than their teachers because the Bible says, what? He that win his soul is what? Wise. And we don't what? We don't win his soul, so we try all we want people to know. Amen. I mean, and give them a head full of knowledge and information that they ain't doing nothing with. So they're wise. Amen. So the scripture will make you what? Wise unto salvation. I think the most important thing you could do is to really admonish people to do something about their spiritual condition. Because that's something that's going to be in play throughout eternity. All right. Amen. Have I made my point? I understand more than the angels because I keep my precepts. I believe revelation now just begins to unfold as you begin to what? Do the mainest thing, I mean the most important thing that what the scripture tells you to do. And the scripture, the most important, if I would have to boil it down, the most important thing that we are commanded to do and that has been assigned to us as believers, if I have to say the most important thing, amen, would be the command, go into all of the world and preach the gospel. Preach the gospel to every creature. So I believe that this is the most important command because that command said, preach the gospel to every creature. All right? And then it says what? Teach them, baptizing them in the name of the what? Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost. So that means that we take the gospel to them. And we get them established in a local church, you get them baptized and all of that. And then he says, teach them to observe, amen, whatsoever I have commanded you. So that the biggest, the greatest, the most important command is to go into the world and what? Preach the gospel. Everybody say the gospel. The gospel is that portion of the word that focuses around what Christ has done to release you from the power of sin. Bible says when we were alienated and enemies in our minds by wicked works, he's reconciled us. And by grace we are saved, and not of what? Not of ourselves. It is the what? The gift of God. I mean, Karen, St. John 3:16. Everybody says St. John 3:16. How many can keep that in your head long enough to just tell somebody how to get saved? Amen. If you can't keep that in your head long enough, then you say, well, I want you to what? Come to church, and I want you to hear it. Amen. From somebody else. Amen. So that is the thing that we want to share with you today. I have this scripture here. James. Now, in my private lessons, kind of warm up, maybe we need some more air. On Wednesday mornings and Wednesday nights, this is going to be the primary thing that we're going to be doing for about 30 days. Because we want everybody to get the flow of it and everybody to be motivated to get their one soul in place. Amen. Beginning next month. Amen. So we're going to make it very exciting because we believe that it is something that everybody can do. I know that many times you've already concluded that I can't do a Bible lesson. Well, it's not about a Bible lesson. The woman at the well, she didn't do a Bible lesson. How many remember Naaman's maid? Y'all remember Naaman's maid? Say it, Naaman. Kings 5. That was Naaman's maid. All right. Now, she knew that her master, Naaman, had what? Leprosy, right? And she had just been brought as a captive out of what? Israel. And this is what she said. She said that if my master could go down in Israel and connect with the prophet, he could cure him of his what? Leprosy. I mean, that's all she said. She says that I know somebody down in Israel, a prophet that could cure you, that could reverse this condition that you've been suffering with all of your life or whatever. And she took him at her word, and she went down, and he went down, he located Elisha, is that right? Elisha. And Elisha wouldn't even come out to what? To even look at him. So Naaman was very frustrated, and he pitched a fit. And he said, how dare this prophet won't even come out and address me and talk to me and address my problem. So he got mad and he told him where to go and to what. He said, I want you to just go down to this dirty river. I mean, he didn't say dirty, but it was one of the worst rivers that he could have what? Went in and what? Washed off. He said, go down to this river, and if you would do that, you will become clean. Your leprosy will just what? Disappear. So he got very disturbed because that was the worst rivers of all the rivers were around. It was a dirty, watered river. But one of his servants stepped up to the plate and said that if your master, if this man had told you to do some great thing, you would have what? You would have been what? You would have been willing to do it. Why can't you just what? Do what the prophet said do. So he persuaded the prophet. He persuaded Naaman. Naaman, the servant, did that came. Amen. Down, amen, from Syria with him. And as a result of him obeying the man of God and going and dipping in that water that was so dirty and filthy, what happened? Amen. Every bit of his leprosy, what? Was just what? Was completely wiped out. He came up completely cured of his leprosy. So that maid succeeded in getting her master healed, but at the same time, the maid succeeded in what? Getting her master saved. Because this is what the master said. The master even said this. He said that, let's turn there. I mean, it was amazing how just one act of obedience on the part of the maid, I mean, she probably didn't even understand all that were involved. All right, so amen. Praise God. All right, 14. Okay, then when he fell and dipped himself seven times in Jordan, according to the saying of the man of God, and his flesh came again like unto the flesh of a little child, and he was clean. And he returned to the man of God, he and all of his company, and came and stood before him, and he said, Behold, now I know that there is no God in all the earth, but in Israel. Now therefore I pray thee, take a blessing of thy servant. And he said, As the Lord liveth, before whom I stand, I will receive none. And he urged him to take it, but he refused. And Naaman said, Shall there not then, I pray, be given to thy servants two mules, a burden of earth? For thy servant will henceforth offer neither burnt offering nor sacrifice unto other gods, but unto the Lord. That man got healed, and what? He was converted. And all the little maid did, she didn't have a whole book full of information and knowledge. She hadn't been walking with the Lord for 25 years. She hadn't been a missionary. She hadn't been an evangelist. She hadn't been a prophet, a teacher. Amen! Amen! All she knew, that there was a what? Man down in Israel, amen, that had what? Turned this thing around. And all she did is what? Go down, I know what I said. Amen. How many can point somebody to the right place where they can get help? Nobody? That's also when it is, because many times you're not going to what? Amen. You might not be. Well, there are so many ways that you can win souls. How many can say amen? All right. Well, I just want to, sometimes I just do it, and then some say, well, you ain't taking this stuff, then you ain't. Amen. Following this, but sometimes I do more. Better doing it this way than over. Let me mention you something here. Let me show you something. Okay, turn over to John. We told you about the woman with the fourth chapter of John. Okay, we see that the woman of Samaria, after she had approached Jesus. Let's look at that. They're coming up, the woman of Samaria. This is our St. John 4. I'm just kind of showing you how easy it is, because the word says go into all of the world and preach the gospel and are baptizing them. In other words, get them established in a church. Amen. And after you get them established, this is what he said, teach them the same thing that I have commanded you. That means teach them how to do the mainest thing, the most important thing, the most essential thing that I have commanded you. The most important thing is to what? Amen. Be able to what? Jesus said, ye are my witnesses in Jerusalem, in Samaria, and to what? The uttermost. In other words, you're just giving proof that Jesus is still what? Alive. You don't always have to what? Know a lot. In fact, the less you know, amen, sometimes the more you depend on the Holy Ghost. Amen. And more effective you can be at what? Pointing somebody. Pointing them to the right what?
Yes.
Place. I wish you would point somebody to me. I wish you would. I mean, that would be the greatest thing you greatest thing you could do. Alright, so I'm just showing you that see, the gospel focus around. If you read all of the scriptures, and we read all of these scriptures all the time, but actually we got to what? Give these scriptures life. Let me just, I'm just holding that St. John, because that's a good illustration there. I want to just go over to Titus, and I'm just going to show you that the main thing, I mean, it's just so simple. If God had made it so hard, amen, how could he expect us to what? Go into all of the world and preach the gospel and get the results that we trying to get. You know, I mean, this is not our vision. God, amen, has what? This is God's vision. I mean, this is something that he's established, and we are to what? Continue the works that Jesus began to do. Over in Titus 1, let me just show you how essential this is. This is Titus 1, everybody said Titus 2, I'm sorry, start to say. Okay, now here you go here, in Titus it says here that, yes, teaches Titus 2 and 11, for the grace of, y'all should have already known where I went to go. For the grace of God that brings salvation hath appeared to all men, teaching us that denied ungodliness and worldly lust, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this world. Okay, the reason why God wants you to live that way, looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior, Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us that he might redeem us, from all what? Iniquity, and purify unto himself a peculiar people, zealous of what? Good works. All right. All that Jesus went through, of the price he paid, the death he died, being made sin for us who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in Christ. In other words, to restore us back to our rightful place in him, so that all of the benefits and privileges and advantages that we need in order to what? To carry out his mission, and to carry out the ministry of reconciliation, so that would be what? Easily accessible to us. The Bible says our sufficiency is of him. He's the one that what? Amen. Came up with this plan. He's the one that chose us in him before the foundation of the world. He's the one that justified us and called us. Amen. And foreordained and amen purpose that we would be conformed to his image. Amen. Before the foundation of the world. I mean, this was his plan. That we would be what? Effective in bringing the world into harmony with what? Christ. Just by sharing with people the gospel of Jesus Christ. And St. John 3:16 is enough to what? To convince a whole lot of folk. For God so what? Loved the world.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Amen. That scripture can what? Amen. Can really impact somebody's heart. That he gave his only begotten son. Amen. See, and all of this was to the end that he might prepare a people, amen, that would be a peculiar people, zealous. What does zealous mean? Zealous mean what? Really excited. Amen. Tell somebody, say, how excited are you?
How excited.
All right, well, we're trying to kindle that excitement today. And I believe that we're going to, amen, begin to get at the, amen, the root of the problem. Amen. Amen. I think that everybody will have a zeal and a fervency. Mama, you'd be, amen, jumping up and down these aisles. We're talking about joy. Amen. Rejoicing in Christ. And amen. Praise God. Worshiping God in the spirit and having no confidence in the flesh. Amen. I think that we could have a whole lot of joy. Amen. In this church.
Amen.
Amen. Y'all looking so sad. All right. All right, the reason why you look so sad is because we have neglected what?
All right.
The mainest thing. That's a bad English word, but if you live with it, amen. The mainest thing. The mainest thing is what? Going to all of the world. All the world will be Brother Holman. He's next to you, Sister Holman. Right? I mean, all over. I was in a barber's chair the other day. And I said, well, here's my opportunity. I won't have to go cross town. I won't have to go to Africa. I mean, these people are all under your nose all the time. All you have to say, if you went into eternity today, if your life was taken, some people say if you died today, it's kind of make it a little harsh. Amen. If your life was taken today and you went into eternity, would you be prepared to meet the Lord? I mean, you can dress it up and make it look as nice as you can, but you want to what, address that issue, and you want to what, get through it and get them what, thinking. That's all you got to say. And they say, no. Then you say, well, I got to have a track with you. Amen. Or just say, I'll get back with you. It's okay for me to bring something over or email you something or get something to you that will give you a little bit more information as to how you can actually make Jesus the Lord of your life. If you don't have anything with you, you can what? Give it back to him. Amen. That makes it real hard, doesn't it? If your life was taken today, you never know. You'd be here today and be gone today. Right? I mean, you can very easily, and some people say, I'm scared to do that. Well, I guess so. All right, well, I gave you that scripture. Zealous! Everybody just says zealous.
Zealous.
Of what kind of works?
Good works.
zealous of good works. And my son said, well, I would, that sounds good, but I don't know what to say. Might say the wrong thing. My tongue might get tired. My brains might not work. Well, they work for everything else. Amen. Why not let it work for Jesus? Food for Christ's sake. Anybody got food for Christ's sake?
Amen.
Amen. Foolishness of what? God is stronger than me. You know what is going to come out. God is going to back you up. He said, hello, I'll be with you all if you just go. Go and what? Amen. To all of the world and what? And what? Preach the gospel. We are commanded to preach the gospel. The gospel. Let me tell you how long the gospel is. If you turn to 1 Corinthians 15, you find out the gospel is so short. It's so short. God, amen. That's the reason I say St. John 3:16 is really enough. Let the Holy Ghost what? Just put in maybe a little something to add to it or break it down, explain it. The gospel is real short. How many can say amen?
Amen.
The Lord just showed me, you know, after going through all of what I went through 6 weeks or so, the Lord just said that you really need to just get back on introducing people to the Gospels. Amen. And just anchoring down, doubling up, just double down, and make sure everybody, amen, confront their number one responsibility. Everybody got to know this. I mean, what hope are we going to have in judgment, the judgment seat of Christ? What hope are we going to have if we neglect? The Bible says, how shall you escape if we neglect so great salvation? I got all these scriptures written down. The judgment seat of Christ is when people are going to be judged according to their what? Works. And some works going to be a little shaky. Some going to be of what? Hay, stubble, and what? Hay, stubble, and what? Wood. Okay, now that means works that are not going to stand the test of what? Time. I think that many times people will try, but they're not going to succeed. Amen. Because many times they won't listen to teaching. Amen. But we can succeed if we can have works to our credit if we just point somebody to Christ. It's like Sister Brown here. She pointed her daughter, her granddaughter. Her daughter's faithful, comes on Thursday morning, bring all of the children to prayer at 5 o'clock. Is that pretty good result?
Excellent.
Amen. Praise God. Let me see. You try that.
I know that's right.
See how far you get. All right. Reveal. I don't know if Sister Jasmine had anything to do with it, but anyway, the butlers are here. Amen. I love these butlers. Amen. Y'all all love them too, right?
Amen.
All right. Amen. Praise God. Nice week to have the friends here. Amen. I'm going to call them and see why they weren't here today. But he promised me they're going to have a whole lot of folk here today.
They sure did. They said last Sunday.
All right, 1 Corinthians 15. I'm going to show you how easy the gospel is. We make it so hard, and sometimes a testimony will really do the job really good. All you have to do, just tell them how God saved you.
Yes,
Lord. That is one of the easiest, the quickest, the best, and perhaps the less threatening way that you can what, share the gospel with people. If God saved you and he's turned your life around, he's quickened you when you were dead in trespasses and sin. If there's been a great change in me, amen, I'm not the person I used to be. This habit was broken. This power over my life was what? Completely eradicated. Now, I'm a new creature in Christ. How many got a testimony?
Amen.
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 All
right, so, all right, well, brother, and this is 1 Corinthians 15, 1. Brethren, I declare unto you the gospel which I preached unto you, which also ye have received, and wherein ye stand, by which also ye are saved, if ye keep in memory what I preached unto you, unless we have believed in vain. For I delivered unto you the first of all that which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins according to the scripture. Christ died for our sins. He became sin for us. There's a lot of scriptures that we can refer to, but suppose you, the person, said, well, I can't call up a whole lot of other stuff if I'm just focusing on one thing. Well, you don't have to. Now, if it were me, somebody else, but I'm just telling you that I'm not going to be as good at it as you are. And not necessarily, okay. I would say Christ became sin for us who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in Christ. And I will throw that in, and that would probably confuse them.
All right.
And all you would do is stick with this, and then probably give them part of your testimony. And you will, the Bible says that he that goeth forth weepeth and beareth precious seed shall doubtless come again with what? Rejoicing.
Amen.
You'll always win when you tell people what the Lord has done for you. You'll always come out a winner. I don't know anybody that could express or articulate that. But how many excuses do we have for not doing it? All right, I'm just going to leave y'all alone. All right. For I deliver unto you, first of all, that which I also received, how Christ died for our sins, according to the scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day, according to the scripture. So the gospel, it just contains three components. Christ died for our sins, and he was what? Buried. He really died, and he was what? In the grave. His body, physical body, was actually in the grave for 3 days and three nights. And we do know, I wouldn't tell them that during that 3 days and nights, his spirit didn't stay in the grave, but his spirit went down to what? Down to hell to atone for our sins. That was the spiritual part of his suffering. See, he suffered what? Physically for us, and he suffered what? Spiritually. His spirit had to what? Suffer. Because that's where the problem really was, in the spirit. The spirit of mankind had to be what? Dealt with. And he had to what? Pay the price to redeem us, not only physically, but redeem us what? Spiritually. Is that right? So he had to what? Suffer spiritually until, amen, praise God, our sins were completely what? Paid for in full. And that was something that God had to determine. After 3 days, God determined that the sufferings in his spirit were adequate to release us from all of the sins if we would turn to Christ in faith and receive him what as Lord and Savior. So you don't have to tell them all of that, because that might confuse them. After they learn a little bit more, you tell them. Just tell the Lord, save me. I was bad for Brother Travis. Amen. Praise God. Just tell him your story. Or you can tell Brother Travis' story to him. You got a little pamphlet. You got a track. Amen. Anybody ever ask you for a track?
Yes.
All right. Ask Brother Travis for a track. He's a man and living in color from our church. Show you what he went through. But just read how God has what? Saved him. How many believe that will work?
Amen.
Amen. But you got a testimony too. I got a good testimony. I was a tough, nut to crack. Oh, I thought I would never be saved. They used to call me Cat Daddy. See how such a deal. But I thought the sun rose and sat around me. I'm going to pray. I'm going to mess up my face. Amen. Nowhere. Amen. Crying and weeping. Amen. Breaking and giving the Lord my life. But that was the main thing that I was ashamed of. That if I went up and received Christ, I might act like all these other folks. Oh, some of them, man, boy, they scream, they holler, they roll, they cry, they shout it. Oh, man, they slobber like all over themselves. Man, it was a mess. And I said, man, I can't help. I can't help that. Oh man, but one thing I rested my sin. The Bible says the foolishness of God is stronger than man. That's the reason the gospel is the power of God.
Amen.
That's the reason why the scripture says the gospel. I'm not ashamed of the gospel. You shouldn't be ashamed of it either.
Amen.
It's the what? Power of God.
Yes.
Unto salvation.
Yes.
Unto everyone that what? Believe. To the Jew, Greek first, and also to the Greek first, Jew first, and also to the Greek. And how do you understand how tough Apostle Paul was? I mean, he had received permission from the king to what? To persecute and to bring people all over that had received Christ. Amen. And what? Lock them up in prison. And he was there holding what? Stephen, I mean, clothes, I believe, when he was stoned to death. I mean, he consented. I mean, he was there. He was a tough person. I mean, he was really low down, and I mean, he was as educated and smart. I mean, he was at the forefront, amen, of all of the teachers there, amen, in Jerusalem. And he was number one, but yet he had all that devil in him. Well, he hated people that was calling on Jesus.
All right.
And when the Lord, amen, took care of him. See, God is pretty wise. Y'all say, y'all need to understand that you ain't doing this yourself. Lord, I'm with you.
Yes. That's good.
Amen. God will confirm the word, whatever your testimony. That's the gospel. He will confirm your what? Testimony.
Yes, he will.
With signs following.
Amen.
All he wants you to do is open your mouth.
Yes.
And he'll what? He'll help you.
Yes, he will.
So I'm going to say, just ask the Savior to help you. Amen. He'll stand behind you. Lord, I'm with you. Lord, I am what? With you. Go 1 mile, he'll go what? 50. All he wants you to do is what? Just step out. Is that right? Apostle Paul was the person everybody feared. And when God knocked him out and knocked him blind for 3 days, and God spoke to Ananias and said, what? I want you to go down on Straight Street. Amen. And what? I want you to what? Lay hands on Apostle Paul. And then, Ananias said, no. Not me. I mean, he was as skinny as he could be. So I said, well, amen. That was Ananias. See, Ananias was just a disciple. I want y'all to get that.
That's good.
Just a disciple. He wasn't no big shot. I don't see anything else about him but a disciple. Just a plain person. How many plain people you got here?
All right.
If it were for plain people, it would work for you, sir.
Amen.
Oh, Jesus. That was a certain disciple at Damascus named Ananias, and to him said the Lord in the vision. Ananias, and he said, behold, I'm here. This is Acts 9:10. And the Lord said unto him, arise and go into the street which is called Straight, and inquire in the house of Judas for one called Saul of Tarsus, for behold, he prayed. And he had seen in the vision a man named Ananias come into him and putting his hands on him that he might receive his sight. Then Ananias answered, Lord, I have heard by many of this man how much evil he hath done to thy saints at Jerusalem. And here he hath authority from the chief priest to ban all that call on thy name.
Yes.
But the Lord said unto him,
go
thy way, for he is a chosen vessel unto me. See, this is the wisdom of God. Ooh, ooh. That makes you wise. Ooh, it's bold. Confident, sure-footed.
Yes.
Go that way, for he is chosen. He is chosen vessel unto me to bear my name before the Gentiles and kings and the children of Israel. For I will show him how great thing he must suffer for my name's sake. See, God was just assuring Ananias that what? He's all right now. Just like Aaron said, he's all right. I'm all right. will show him how great things he must suffer for my name's sake. And Adonai went his way, entered into the house, and put his hands on him, said, Brother Saul, the Lord even Jesus that appeared unto thee in the way as thou camest and sent me, that thou mightest receive thy sight and be filled with the Holy Ghost. And immediately there fell from his eyes as it had been scales, and he received sight forthwith, and arose and was baptized. And when he had received me, he was strengthened. Then was Saul certain days with the disciples which were at Damascus. Watch it, watch this. Straightway he preached Christ. Just that quick. In the what? Synagogues, that he is the Son of God. All that heard him were amazed, and said, It's not this he that destroyed them which call on this name in Jerusalem, and came hither for that intent, that he might bring them bound unto the chief priests? But Saul increased the more in strength, and confounded the Jews which dwelt at Damascus, proving that this is very Christ. Now how much did Ananias have to know to do that? All he had to do was be what? Open for the voice of God. How many can say? He just be open. God told him what to do. How many know God will tell you exactly what you do if you're just open? If you've already concluded what? This is a mountain that I can't climb. I don't have nothing to do with what my mouth was said of the gospel. See, some have already made up their mind that reaching out and sharing the word is just for certain people. It's for me, and the priests and the leaders, so perhaps, amen, which are going to be less effective than anybody else probably. I'm putting myself in the same category, because sometimes just what? Throw out too much stuff. Amen. Try to get people saved. Woo! Y'all got it here. Oh, she almost stopped. Amen. Praise God. How long have I been up? But then, it seems like it should be that quick. I have a whole lot more stories to tell you. All right. Well, this week, y'all going to be hearing from me. Amen. Because this is the end of our rest. I want to be resting the Lord. I'm going to be persuading you day and night. Amen. Praise God that we got to what? Start talking to Paul. I mean, not going out of your way. Just what? People all around. You may run a lot of folks. You can have a lot of them here. Amen. We just didn't do nothing with them. Because probably half of us won't even what? Go up and meet them. Some of these things got to be changed. This is a church. Y'all sure quiet today. See, if we were all doing what I'm talking about down before, we'd just be dancing up and down the aisle. Everybody. Some of y'all ain't never seen dance. Not even leave. Not even get excited. Because what? Joy. Amen. See, joy is the result of what he that goeth forward, bearing precious seeds. Woo, glory. Shall doubtless come again with rejoicing. That makes you so happy when you can go out, and even if people don't respond, you feel better.
That's right.
Because what? That blood has been what? Released from your hand.
Yes.
How many are going to next month start? Today is the last day of the month?
Yes.
Starting tomorrow. How many are going to what? Get somebody in these seats? And all month, you're just going to be what? Dealing with them on the basis of what? But the gospel. See, the gospel message, I could read four or five passages, and every single passage, four or five or six scriptures, all of them would be what? Setting forth the gospel. What I read is like, 1 Corinthians 15, because it deals with what? Christ died for our sins. He was buried, and the third day, he rose again, and he did it for you. He loved you. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. That's a part of it, right? When we were dead in trespasses and sin, he quickened us together with him. By grace, we're saved. Amen. I mean, you can go on and on. All of these scriptures, you find them all over the Bible. They are expressing Amen. The gospel in a different way, but all of it is based on 1 Corinthians 15. Amen. Chapter 15, verses 1, 3, and 4. Amen. I want you to be well aware of it, but we don't want you to, amen, depend a whole lot on what? On scripture, or you might not be, you know, but but you do know what God has done for you.
Yeah.
How many can say amen?
Amen.
And how many appreciate what God has done for you?
Amen.
Somebody said, if I'm going to believe in your Redeemer, you're going to have to look more redeemed yourself.
Come on.
That's right. I mean, these long faces that are being excited a bit, no joy, no enthusiasm. Hey, amen. So, you know, just take it or leave it attitude. My Lord, I ain't going to what? Convince nobody. That's the reason why the Bible said be filled with what? The Spirit. God wants you filled with the Holy Ghost and with what? Fire. Everybody said fire. And how many believe that you can stand a little bit more fire? I'm going to tell you how to get that fire. Go forward, weeping and bearing precious seeds. Put that testimony on the land. Tell them what God has done for you. Amen. You'll come back rejoicing. Amen. Come back rejoicing. Bring your sheaves with you. Amen. So we want to reach out, get people in these seats. And all month, we're going to be what? Challenging them with the gospel.
Yes.
And challenging them to come and be in Christ their lives. Amen. I believe we can do it. How many believe we can pull it off?
Amen.
Maybe we can climax it with a big dinner, family and friends. Amen. Let's do it. How many we can see this church floor just like a lot of y'all here? I mean, this will be easy if everybody would just get one. Wouldn't it be, look around. Wouldn't it be easy? Amen. All right, let's all stand. Amen. I never gave you